Right now, we're kind of friendly to church. If we attend church, we come to church, and we're involved in a little bit. But being a part of the church, really, that's when you become family. What you realize when you become family, it's really the bond of belief and love and care for one another that is really goes deeper than even blood relationship. That God joins you into a family where you care about the person next to you, even though they don't look anything like you. Even though maybe not even act like you, but God joins you together. So what we're doing is we're walking through this series together for 7 weeks. How does the church look like a family? And we are focusing on this. I mean, we are taking every group is walking through this. And we're going to do this 3 times in 2017 where we walk through one specific study. It's going to take up about 20 to 19 weeks of our 52 weeks in 2017. So not even the majority of our weeks. But we think during these weeks, as we are unified, going deep into a topic, that God is going to yield great fruit. Just like when you're in a life group and you're studying something, and anytime you're in a group format, it's like the greenhouse effect of learning. You're all close, you're all near, the atmosphere is perfect, and the growth is just immense. Well, what we want to do is amplify that. We want to magnify that exponentially. We think if we're all pulling in the same direction, praying, thinking about the same topic, God's going to yield great growth. So I'm excited to jump into this. Now, as we do this, I want you to take out your bulletin, find notes, find those things. What I want you to do is I want you to think about a blind date. Think about a blind date. Okay, nobody's really laughing, so apparently all your blind dates were good, or maybe you never had to go on a blind date, right? But just think about a blind date, just even the concept of a blind date. Because the concept of a blind date is a little bit, disappointing. Usually blind dates don't go well, right? I mean, normally they don't. Now, sometimes maybe you fell in love, you're sitting next to the blind date of 15 years ago. Okay, praise God. But that's a rarity, right? That's an anomaly. Blind dates usually don't work out, right? It's like Forrest Gump said, right, in that famous line, life is like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're going to get. That is totally true about a blind date. You never know what you're going to get. Right, you walk in the room, and ladies, you come in, you want the knight in shining armor who's going to lead you into the American dream. And what do you get? A middle-aged man in skinny jeans hoping to level up his Warcraft character as he sits in his grandmother's basement eating Cheetos, right? There's a switch. You've been duped, right? The blind date usually doesn't work because you don't know anything going in. There's no prior information. It reminds me of a saying my grandpa used to say, Paul, when he used to take me fishing, that's why they call it fishing and not catching, right? That's sometimes how a blind date is, right? You don't always catch a fish, or at least one you want to catch, right? So then you practice catch and release and never call again, right? And block his number. A blind date is so incredibly hard to see be successful because you have no prior information. I mean, you come in and it's a cold sell. I mean, it's a confrontational, hard, cold sell. You don't know anything about this person. You have no prior information to determine if you're compatible, if you even like the same things. What if they're a Yankees fan or a Dodger fan? You don't want that in your life. You don't want that poison. Wrong demographic. I'm sorry. What if they're a Giants fan, right? You don't want to come into that having no prior information. It's almost impossible to know if you're compatible. And I think we would all agree, based on some of your laughter there, that really a blind date is never the first option, right? It's always plan B, C, D, or E or something. It's way down the line. And yet, for some reason, this is sometimes our first option when it comes to God. We set up our friends and families on blind dates with God. Now, let me explain. It's like this. It's like, You're talking to your friend and you're saying, hey, Stacy, you know what? We've been friends for a long time and I know we've never talked about this. I know I've never even hinted about it. But you know what, Stacy? I want to talk to you about your death, hell, and the meaning of life. Right? Not right there. Stacy at that moment is thinking, hey, the guy, the Warcraft guy in the skinny jeans eating Cheetos, he sounds more appealing than this conversation. Right, we tend to just throw it on them, and they're surprised. It's coming out of left field, and they've never had any encounter with God prior to this moment. So when we bring up spiritual conversations, when we bring up some God talk, it just seems totally out of the blue. And when we try to sell them on this message, it's a cold sell. It's a confrontational, hard, tough sell. I want to make the case to you today that God is not a blind date. Take the pen out of the seat back in front of you. Pull out in your bulletins where you see notes. It's going to be this little insert in here. There's some scripture passages right here. This is the main passage we're covering. If you open up, here's the life group questions, which is also in your booklet. Now, this is going to be nice because during the series, you can bring this booklet with you. It has all the questions for 7 weeks. It has sermon notes for you. It has a place where you can put the big idea. All the stuff is right there in that booklet. So you can keep bringing this or get this every week, or you can just keep bringing this if you're a life group member. On the back side there where it says notes, you see where it says big idea? Take the pen out of the seat back in front of you. Write this down. This is the big idea. Very simple. God is not a blind date. God is not a blind date. You should be showing God all the time to your friends and to your family. They should never be surprised about your talk about God. They should never be caught off guard. They should never sit at the table thinking, who is this person across from me? They should never feel that way about God because you've been showing him. Really, maybe a better way, a better analogy is God is not a blind date. Rather, God is a group date, right? He's always there. When you're in the room, God's in the room. When you're in the home, God's in the home. When you're at work, God's at work. And so when you start to have a conversation with somebody, they've realized that God has been there the whole time. They would never, I don't know if you've ever gotten this surprising question, this is a bad appraisal on your Christian life, of when you start mentioning, oh man, I can't do that, I got church on Sunday. And they say, what? You're a Christian? No. That's a bad sign. Right? That means you're setting them up on a blind date. They should not be surprised by it. And I think this is Jesus' strategy when it comes to reaching the world, is that Jesus doesn't want us to set God up on a blind date. Rather, he is more interested in setting up the group date, where God is always there in the group. Let me show you this. Go to Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5. And I want to show you how Jesus uses two analogies, two terms, just kind of like I did with the blind date idea. He uses the idea of salt and light. And it's going to show us that really when we live our lives, the faith that we talk about should be the faith that we live. That people should see God on us before they ever hear God from us. And it should be so evident in our lives that we worship God, that they would be drawn and attracted to it. The title of the message is called Friendly Church. Our faith is so friendly, so persuasive, that people see it and think, what is going on here? I want a part of that. Can you explain what that is? Does your life beg questions from those around you? Or are they completely unaware that you have any spiritual commitments? Let's look at Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, starting with verse 13. I'm going to read the whole thing and then we're going to kind of go at it in some different angles here. Let's read Matthew chapter 5, verse 13. Jesus says, "You are the salt of the earth. And if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden. Nor do people light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a stand. And it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven." Jesus right now is in the Sermon on the Mount. He's about to give probably the largest teaching that we have of Jesus, like consecutive teaching that we have of Jesus is right there in the Sermon on the Mount. And what Jesus is about to give, this is kind of his introduction, if you will. What he's about to give is a bunch of demands he has on his followers. You should live like this and like this and like this and like this. It's almost like Jesus is giving the law again. Now, before Jesus even gets to that point, he gives him first his introduction right here of the purpose of our obedience is so that people may see it and glorify God, that they may see the show, the display of God on us, and then they'll understand who he is. Our obedience will set people up and move them away from being on a blind date. And then he gives us what to obey. But before he even gets to that point, look down at your Bible in Matthew chapter 5, verses 2 through 12. He gives what's called the Beatitudes. Before he ever gets to the demands, He says, you're blessed. Now, Jesus is probably talking to his followers, his most intimate followers, the disciples. Right now, he's addressing them. The crowd probably grows as the sermon goes on. But at the beginning, he looks at his disciples and says, you're blessed, you're blessed, you're blessed, you're blessed. And then he makes demands. This is normally God's pattern before he ever gives a demand. He reminds us of our situation, our standing with him. He says, you're blessed. He did this with the nation of Israel on the Mount of Sinai. Before he gave the law to them, he reminded them, I delivered you. I'm the God who moved you out of slavery from the land of Egypt. I brought you through that sea. I protected you and kept you safe. And now that you are blessed, now I'm giving you demands. Right? God doesn't really wait for us. We don't really start this thing. He starts it. And then he says, this is how this relationship is going to work. So he says, you're blessed, and then he gives these demands. And these demands are to be salt and to be light. And what does that mean? Let's look at them individually, and then we'll look at them together. Salt. Jesus, what do you mean for us to be salt of the earth? Now, what we could do is we could read this in and say, okay, what are all the purposes of salt? That's what we're supposed to be. Well, one of the purposes of salt is it dissolves snails. Not that I know that or ever did that as a kid. Right? But it's true. Don't try it out. Don't test it out, but it's true. Now, is that what we're supposed to do? Okay, we're the salt of the earth, so our job is to kill snails. No, we can't say it's a one-to-one correlation. Everything that salt is, we are. What is Jesus talking about? Now, normally what we do in a 21st century mindset, especially in America, when we think of salt, we think of food, right? We think of enhancing flavor. Put salt on it, it tastes better. Now, that's not a first century mindset, though. When they looked at salt, it wasn't mostly as a flavor enhancer. It was a preserver because they didn't have refrigeration then. So in order to cause their meat to not decay, they had to pack it with salt to prevent decay, to prevent death, to prevent rot of their meat. They had to pack that with salt. Salt was essential for this. I mean, all their food, basically, preparation and preservation was based off the essential nature of salt. They needed it. It was vital to their everyday life. It wasn't just a little thing they put on their table like we do. Everybody used it. Everybody needed it. So how are we like that? You see, when God looks at the world, it's like a first century mind looking at a piece of meat. Thinking, how am I going to preserve this? How am I going to keep this? How am I going to prevent rot? And when God looks at the world, he says, how am I going to prevent this world from moral decay? How am I going to prevent them from death? How can I preserve them? God looks at it and packs it with salt. And who is that? That's us. That's us. How does God enact good in this world? It's through us. And I think we can look at the 21st century now as we have been here for a long time. Mankind has been here for a long time, and we've taken progressive steps, and we've made enhancements, and we've developed, if you will. Have any of those steps of progress, have any of those enhancements made us morally good or spiritually faithful to the Lord? I think our progress and our innovation rather has increased our capacity for destruction. 1,600 years ago, 2,000 years ago, killing one man at one time was a difficult task. We can kill millions with a push of a button. Millions. Two men flying in a plane can drop a piece of metal that contains the destruction of countries, cities. Have we really progressed morally? Have our innovations really moved us spiritually closer to the things of God? No. I think Romans 1 describes a picture. The more and more we move away from God, the more we spiral down. Not progress. We move away, and God just leaves us to that. To that downward spiral. But what prevents that from going, from unfurling, from just skyrocketing down? What prevents the moral market of America from just hitting rock bottom, the salt of the earth? Christians. How does God enact good in this world through you? How does God prevent moral decay? You. How does God stop this world from just the cycle of death? You. Your good acts preserve this world. He saw the moral meat, if you will, the rottenness of the world. He said, how can I preserve this? I can pack in a bunch of believers. I can put them in there and they will preserve this thing. They will keep it. They will prevent death. And then he says, we're the light of the world. We're the light of the world. Now, what does that mean? That imagery is all over the Bible, especially in the writings of John. Light and darkness. Light represents knowledge of God or obedience to God. Darkness represents ignorance of the things of God or just defiance and disobedience. So how are we the light of the world? The idea there is of giving revelation. We give the message of God. When Jesus Christ says that he is the light of the world, what's the idea? He brings light and he shows this is God's way. This is God's will. This is how to get things right. I think these two images are tied together. I think there's no accident here that Jesus uses salt and light together. If salt prevents decay, what does light do? Light shows the decay. The imagery is kind of like this. It's like we have a wound, and the wound is hidden by midnight. We can feel the pain. We can feel the tingle. We know it itches. But the darkness, the absence of light, keeps us from knowing the depth of the infection in the wound, the true severity of our situation. And it's not till the sun comes we realize how deep the rot is, how bad the infection is. This world is decaying. This world is dying, and they don't even know it. They don't even have the light to see it. They're unaware of this diagnosis, so therefore they don't seek out the cure. And God is saying, this is what you are. Christ is saying to his followers, this is what you are. I want to rescue this world. I want to free them from death, so I'm putting you in. You are the salt of the earth. Get out there. By your good acts, get out there and save this world from moral decay and show them the light, my message of hope. My message that life can be theirs, eternal life, that this rate of decay can be reversed, that hope can be held on to, that people won't have to die separated from me. Show them, shine this light. Now let's look at them together. I want you to look down at these verses again. Look down at them kind of together in Matthew chapter 5. Look at verse 13 and verse 14. In my Bible, and if you don't have a Bible, by the way, I want to give you one. You know, every Sunday we say this is a Bible-dependent service. We always come back to this, always. And if you don't have one, please just grab one off the back shelf here. We reload them every service. We keep putting more. It's free. Take it. Or if you don't want to take one right now, at the end of the service, just find me. I will give you a Bible for free. We intentionally don't put all the verses on the screen or in your bulletin because we want you to bring this book. Okay, but I want you to look at Matthew chapter 5, verses 13, and then look at verse 14. Just look how it starts. Take your pen that you wrote down that big idea with, and let's highlight some words here. First word is you. Look at verse 13. You are the salt of the earth. Look at verse 14. You are the light of the world. Circle the word you. Now, why is that important? It's important because in the Greek, which this is written in, that word is not needed. It's not needed. The verb implies the subject. So anytime you have a verb with the subject, there's a sense of emphasis there. It's emphatic. He's making a point. He's saying, you yourselves are the light of the world. You yourselves are the salt of the earth. Now, why would he do that? Why be emphatic about it? Because Jesus is being restrictive. He's saying, you're it. You're it. There's no B team. Like the starters are on the field and the bench is empty. There's no backup plan. Jesus looking at his followers and saying, you're it. You're the hope of the world. If this world is ever going to turn or change or move away from its immorality, move to something spiritual, move to worshiping God, seeing the light of who he is, it's not legislation. It's not a governor, a president, a policy, a program. It's God's people, the followers of Jesus Christ. They are it. Jesus is saying, this is not the Pharisees. This is not even Israel. God's Old Testament people, it's those who follow Christ. They're the only ones who can prevent this world from decay. They're the only ones who can dispel the darkness, because they're only ones who have the message of Jesus Christ. You're it. There is no plan B. The hope of the world is the church, not anything else. Not anything else. Yes, it's true that we can fund programs that dig wells. We can fund programs that pull people out of the sex slave industry. And should we fund those things? Should we do those things? Absolutely. But there is a greater danger than a thirsty throat. There is a greater danger even than an enslaved girl for this life. And the greater danger is eternal loss. All of those things are temporary ailments, and we should do something about them. We should be salt and try to stop those things, but we cannot miss the larger picture, that these temporary loss pale in comparison to eternal loss, to eternal darkness, to eternal banishment. And there's only one organization that does anything to prevent that. And that's the church speaking the message of Jesus Christ, full of his followers who act as salt and act as light. Look down again at verses 13 and 14. It says you, emphatically, you, restrictive. It's just you. It's your job to make sure the world is not on this blind date, but that they see who God is. The second word there is you are. You are. You are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. Now, this is something very, very interesting. You know, if you read on the analogy of the salt, the idea there is if the salt has lost its purpose, its usefulness, it is thrown out, it is thrown away. So should we then therefore interpret if a Christian is not shining, if a Christian is not being useful, if a Christian is not acting as salt, if a Christian is not doing good to prevent moral decay in this world, if a Christian is not sharing the message of Jesus Christ, if a Christian is not shining, if a Christian is useless, are they thrown out? Is that what that imagery is supposed to express? Now, I think we're forcing too much into the text if we read that. Right, the analogy there is emphasizing purpose and usefulness. This is what salt is supposed to do. But salt cannot be anything but salt. Salt can't lose its saltiness. It's chemically impossible. And really, the rest of the analogies are going to show us there is an inevitability to your shining, to your good works. It's organic. It's natural. The second analogy he uses with light, he says, a city set on a hill cannot be hidden. What is Jesus saying there? The city is high. It's lifted up. It's bright. There's no way you can hide that. Its situation prevents it from its concealment. You cannot stop light from shining. Jesus says that's not his purpose. He lights the lamp and he doesn't put a basket over it. He has made the light to shine. He's made the salt to be salty. And we are this. This isn't a promise. You will be the salt. We can't read that way. You will be light. No, there's no hypothetical here. There's no possibility. This isn't like the second step of the Christian life. You make a decision to follow Jesus Christ. Now you decide, okay, well, will I shine? Will I be salt? It's not there. The idea is you are this. It's a statement of fact. And yet Jesus commands us to shine. So how does that work? How do you deal with that kind of mystery there? You are, therefore be. Well, this is New Testament ethics right here. We see these statements all over the scriptures. You are, therefore be. Paul in the book of Romans says you're dead to sin. You are. There's a statement of fact. You're dead to sin. But then in just a couple verses, he says, now put to death the deeds of the flesh. Wait, I thought I was already dead. If I'm dead, then how can I put this thing to death? How does that work? Another analogy I think is helpful. Let's take the salt or the light idea. If you think of it like this, when God brings you to faith, when you become a Christian for the first time, it's like the light bulb turns on. It's like God is standing at the switch and he just hits it. Bink. And inevitably what happens? Organically what happens? Naturally what happens? The domino just hits and it just falls. The light shines. Now then, how do we make for room for this responsibility, for this command, for this demand, then shine? I think this is the best analogy. It's like God turns on the light, but it's on a dimmer switch. Right? I have two dimmer switches in my house. And every time I tell my son to turn off the light, you know what he does? He dims it. He doesn't turn it off. Why? Because the dimmer switch is fun to play with. He thinks he's like a little DJ. Right? That's what he thinks. And I'm like, Paxton, that doesn't work. Because if he dims the light all the way, does it turn it off? No. At least that's how mine works. He's got to flip the switch to turn it off. See, this is what God has done. When you become a Christian, he turns on the light. But there's a dimmer switch. And that's up to you. How are you going to shine? Right, tomorrow, today, when you leave and you go to lunch, and you're talking to that waitress that's serving you, how are you going to shine? What's the magnitude? You can't stop it. A Christian who never shines, a light that never produces light is not light. It's not. But if God has birthed faith, true faith in your heart, you will inevitably shine. The question is, how much? To what degree? That's up to you. That's up to you when you go to your workplace. That's up to you when you go into your home. That's up to you when you speak to your children. That's up to you when you talk to your friends and your family members. That's up to you. But naturally inside of you, there's something heating up. Right? God has lit that candle and placed it on a table and wants it to give light to the whole room. You can't stay on dim forever. It'll burn you. Ever put your hand over a candle? How long can you hold it there? Depends on your pain tolerance, right? That still some light will break through the little gaps in your fingers, but you can't hold it there forever. I think this is what happens with Christians. God lights it, and there's no putting it out. That's not how it works. And you may try to hide it a little bit, conceal a little bit for the sense of, well, I want to be friendly to people. I want to be nice to people. I want people to feel comfortable around me. I don't want them to be like, oh, you're the Jesus guy again. I want to be cordial. I want to be nice. And I want to separate my faith, my Sunday morning stuff from my Monday work stuff. And we kind of do this. You do that long enough, you know what will happen? It'll burn inside of you. God won't allow that to continue. He'll just turn up the heat until you're like, all right, fine. Fine, I gotta let this thing shine. I gotta let this thing out. And if that's not your experience with your Christian faith, I think you need to ask yourself, is that candle even lit? Are you even a Christian? Because you must shine. There's no option not to. You are light. Your candle is lit. Let's keep reading. You're the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. Go down just a couple of words here. You are the salt of, circle this word, the earth. You are the light of the world. Circle that one, the world. The earth and the world. Now, this is a part that I think is very interesting because Jesus is kind of in the second part of his introduction, if you will. The first part of his introduction to the Sermon on the Mount is the Beatitudes. And then he goes to this part, being salt, being light, shining so people can see the glory of who God is. But Jesus, right before that, just look at the Beatitudes. If you just flip in your Bible, look at the person described right here. He says this, blessed are the poor, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are those who are meek, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness, blessed are the merciful, blessed are the pure in heart, blessed are the peacemakers, blessed are those who are persecuted. Now, Jesus says these people right here will be blessed. But all of these circumstances, all of these virtues are very counterintuitive to the world. If you were to describe a person like this, you wouldn't be describing someone of success. If a person is going to do great in the world's eyes, they're not the meek. They're not mourners or peacemakers. They don't hunger and thirst after righteousness. They hunger and thirst after authority, power, influence, and riches. They're not the ones who are persecuted, who would consider themselves poor in spirit. These aren't the winners. These are the losers. These guys are in last place. So Jesus, for about 12 verses, describes, this is who my people are. And at the world's vantage point, they're losers. They're on the bottom of the barrel. But Jesus says, no, that's not how it is. The world may see these people as having no means of reward, but they're foolish in that appraisal. Because these virtues, these circumstances are means of great reward. From an eternal perspective, from a divine vantage point, these are the ones rewarded. So what Jesus shows us is a different ethic, a different list of virtues, a different person, if you will, from the world. And oftentimes what we do as Christians is we say, I'm different, therefore I have to be separate. Because I value something different than those in this world, I have to be separate. I don't value this career mentality of just climb and climb and climb the ladder of influence, build your wealth, hoard everything, save everything for yourself, give only your immediate family the abundance of your work. Right? Because we don't do that because it's different. It's just a different ethic. It's a different center. It's a different pursuit of life. Because we're different, we think, well, we just have to be separate. But then right after that, Jesus says, go into the earth, go into the world. We're different, that's true, but we're not meant to be separate. Not even if they persecute us. I look down at your Bible again in verse 11 and then verse 13. I said this idea of salt in verse 13 was the idea that we are preserving the world from moral decay. We're preserving it. But if you look in verses 11 and 12, we're preserving the very world that's persecuting us. Right, 11:12 says, blessed are you when others revile you or persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For so they persecuted the prophets. They're killing their doctors. We're there to save lives. We're there to come in. We're there to do heart surgery, to help them out. We see them about to flatline and we walk in and all the patient can do is fight us. And push us away, persecute us, call us names. But does that stop us? Absolutely not. Just as a child would throw a fit when you try to put Bactine, right, on their wound, I don't care how hard my daughter fights me, I will clean that wound. Because even though it hurts her, it's what's best for her. When we're salt, and when we're light, and we're dispelling darkness that people hold on so dearly to their heart, when we are salt to their moral degradation, when we're salt saying this is wrong, you must do this, when we're doing that, you think people will applaud those appraisals, applaud that news? Not always. But we are here to preserve even those that we persecute, because we're not going to separate ourselves from them, even though we're different than them. We will engage them. We will shine. And we're going to shine, why? Because that's exactly what Jesus did. Flip your page over to Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4. I think this is also very interesting and in some sense kind of gives you the weight and the gravity of our responsibility as believers. We're the salt, and we're the light of the world. But before Jesus ever says that to his followers, that statement is said about him. Just one chapter over there in Matthew chapter 4, when it speaks about Jesus making his home base, if you will, Capernaum, he's moving. John the Baptist has been arrested. He leaves, goes to another place. He goes to this land, if you look at Matthew chapter 4, verse 15, and a prophecy is therefore fulfilled. And this is what it says. In the land of Zebulun, in the land of Naphtali, the way of the sea, beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles, the people dwelling in darkness have seen a great light. And for those dwelling in the region and shadow of death, on them light has shone. Jesus Christ displayed light. Jesus Christ shined. And now he says, you do the same thing. Wow. I have the same mission as Jesus Christ. Now, he does it a lot better than I do. Right? Amen to that. But he still calls me to it. He still calls me to shine. He still calls me to be light. You know, if you're a Christian, you're a believer in this room, you've been following Jesus Christ for a while, we always move our service to a time of reflection, but before we ask some question of ourselves, I want to ask you a question. And I want to introduce it by a quote. And this quote has bothered me ever since I was in high school. And here's the quote. This is from Mahatma Gandhi talking about Christianity. And this is the quote. I remember the first time hearing this in my history class when I was in high school. And I was a Christian for about 2-3 years at that point. And this is the statement. Now just think of the idea of salt and light. Think of the idea that we are not supposed to be setting people up on blind dates, but rather we should be shining God all the time so when they hear God talk, they're like, yeah, this makes sense. It matches your life. You're showing me him all the time. Now, I don't agree with Gandhi. I don't agree with his position on spirituality, on religious things. But a very influential figure, and I wouldn't say a man of spite and anger, and yet this is his appraisal of our faith. Look at what he says. He says, I like your Christ. I do not like your Christians. Your Christians are so unlike your Christ. Oh, man, we're pretty dim there. Let me just ask you this question. Does your life point to him or away from him? Does your life point to him or away from him? As an employee, doing your work, doing your job, when you punch the clock and you get in there and you start working and doing maybe those tasks that you feel like are a little minimal to you or meaningless, do you do it with such an attitude, such a diligence, knowing that I'm shining right now, I'm shining, and there's an audience around me, and they're here to see him and not me, I'm going to shine? Or do you just come in late and do half-effort work? Why would somebody want to follow that God? Why would somebody want to follow that religion that you profess? Or maybe in your home. Right? As Christian parents, we want our kids to inherit the faith, right? We want them to know it. We want them to see it. But are kids really going to find our faith appealing when all we are as parents are impatient with them, hard on them, have no time for them, too busy for them, uninvolved in their life? And then we feel betrayed when they don't adopt the very faith that we showed them to be cheap? How do you shine? How do you shine? Does your life attract people to the God that you serve? Or does it repel them? Now, maybe you're not yet a Christian, right? You're still trying to piece this whole thing together. You're trying to figure out how all these pieces work. And if you're a skeptic in here, this is the place for you to be, man. It really is. I'm glad you're here asking spiritual questions. I want to explain to you this, that every good work we do, and I'll be honest with you, we don't always do good, right? Well, just admit, as a Christian, on behalf of the entire church and all of Christendom, I'll apologize, we don't always do a great job. But the good that we do, the good things and good actions that we do, I will say, we do them because he was good to us. The Bible says in 1 John, we love because he first loved us. The good that we do before you is not a resume of our credit. It's a response of his goodness. He's been so good to us. And that's the good I hope you see. That even though this small glimmer of good that we do to you, an act of charity, a kind word, A warm cup of coffee, a handshake, all of those little goods pale in comparison to the great good done by God our Father in sending his Son, Jesus Christ, to die on the cross for our sins. All of our good pales in comparison to that. And all of our good points to that, that God in heaven said, yes, the crimes committed, the treasonous acts, the breaking of my law, every lie, every lust, every bit of anger, every time you didn't put me first, all of those crimes, I'm willing to take the punishment for. I'm willing to take that on. And Christ took on that burden on the cross, died for us, paid for our sin, rose again from the grave and said, now you can be free from all these things. Your debt has been paid. The Bible says all you have to do is believe and confess. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead and confess him as Lord. If you do that, you get into this family. And I encourage you to do that. Don't wait. I'm sorry that all of our good doesn't paint at all times a beautiful picture of who God is. But let me tell you, we are trying and we are striving in that direction, but we're not perfect. But the perfect one did the greatest good, and that was sending his Son so you may have hope and forgiveness of sins. And I encourage you and I implore you to make that decision.